Guest Back Watches, my name is Tim, and in this episode I'd like to speak about divers and about bodyboard surfing. And if you ask me now, this is not exactly a watch topic. Yes, you're right, but I want to talk about bodyboard surfing because it fascinates me. And if you don't like this topic, then skip. I need 5 or 6 minutes to that, and then we'll talk about divers, a certain type of divers, but now about bodyboard surfing. There's not an affiliate link in the description. I don't want to talk you in to buy something. I just want to report about a fascinating hobby, and I just want to give you 3 reasons why you should consider bodyboard surfing. And reason number one, it's super exciting, especially if you are a little bit like me, if you live in a big city, if you work in an office, if you're not exactly in contact with nature, then it's super exciting being in the ocean. And I'd like to spend my summer vacation in Portugal, and there you have gigantic waves. And if you want to swim in that ocean, this would be your last adventure. So you need proper equipment. You need a wetsuit, you need a board, and some other things. I will show you that. So this is the first reason, being in the ocean with no ground under your feet. Fascinating, absolutely fascinating. I can show you that. Second reason is it's easy. Compared to the real surfing, it's easy. It's really easy to learn. I mean, if you want to surf with a big board, then you need 2 weeks to learn, I think, the first steps. Then you can stand on your board and then you can catch the first small waves. But if you want to really have fun, then you need years to learn this, or correct me if I'm wrong. And the third reason, it's easy to handle the equipment and to buy the equipment. You need, of course, a wetsuit. I use a shorty, but this you can buy a full-blown wetsuit, very inexpensive. And then you need a board, buy a good one, don't buy cheap things. A good bodyboard costs more than 100 euros or more than, let's say, 110 US dollars, okay? You want quality. And then you need a leash. Buy the best leash you can find. Your life hangs on this thing. This is basically to tie the board to your body, like this, without a shirt, of course, without a shirt cuff. And the next thing you need are fins. If you want in the ocean with a bodyboard and the wetsuit and a lifeguard sees you without fins, he will not let you go into the waves. Absolutely not. And so you need good fins, the best you can afford. These are Churchill's. This is the Ferrari under the fins, and they are super tight and super robust. You can use this without an extra leash. It's very tight on your feet and that way. And even the biggest wave will not wash off this fin from your feet. And so, absolutely recommendation. And yeah, I've used them, I think, 3 years now, and they are, okay, there's sand in it, but the condition is like new. Great product. And yeah, those are the 3 reasons why you should consider bodyboard surfing. And there are 3 major mistakes you can make, and I've done them all. And I'm kind of proud of that. It's idiotic, but I am. First, the current pulls you out. You let the current pull you out on the ocean. This is dangerous, of course. I've done this. And the second is getting knocked out by your own board, unconsciousness in the ocean. I've done this as well. And the next thing is getting in the way of the big fish, and I've done this too. And I will tell you at the end of this video how I've handled that situations, okay? And so now we can talk about the watch, the compressor watch. I was in need of a beta watch for the beach, not necessarily a proper diver watch, but in most cases this is a diver watch. And then I speculated, or I thought about the Steinhardt Ocean 1, 39 millimeters. I've mentioned that this in this video, or in the comments, I think. And I mean, it's a good watch, sapphire crystal EDA Elaboré. The bracelet is very well made, and overall it's a good watch for 500, I think 500 is the price, no, 500 euros or 550 US dollars. But of course it's a bloody homage, right? It's a copy of the GMT, the Rolex GMT. And so, I don't know if this is a good idea wearing that watch. And then I wanted not an homage, but a watch, a diver, which is inspired by another very famous diver or a variety of divers. And then I saw in a forum, a review of this watch, and the people went crazy over the watch. And I had to agree. And then I saw it for sale a couple of weeks later, I think, same forum, and I bought it. And this is the Landeron diving watch, a French company. Landeron? French? What's going on? And if you are a little bit in the watch world involved in some topics, then you know, of course, the name Landeron. Landeron was a Swiss company, and they've manufactured movements. If you buy an old chronograph, Swiss from the 60s, let's say, 18 karat gold, often it's a very delicate watch. But the movement there is super robust, and it ticks then a Venus or a Landeron. And a Landeron is, as I said, robust movement. Everybody can, or every watchmaker can fix it. It works outstandingly well, but they are not long in existence. And every time a good name in the watch world is not longer used by a company, another company sneaks by and want to grab that name, and they've done this with Landeron as well. French company printed then Landeron on a compressor watch. Is this good? I don't know. Let's find out. I will show you everything in the light box, but let me give you a little bit of context, because I thought, Tim, do you really know what a compressor is? A compressor watch. And then I said, yes. And this was not so accurate, I have to say. I've done a little bit of research, and what I've learned is that the first misconception is that people think those two crowns are the key feature of a compressor. This is wrong. You can find small dress watches, and they are compressor watches with one crown, of course. And what I've learned is that the compressor watch is the most important part here is the case back. It's the case back, because it reacts to water pressure. The water presses the case back tight on the watch, and then it's sealed. Same method with the crowns, of course, but the key feature was really the case back. And the idea is this: if you imagine a pool 10 meters deep, and then you have a little coin on the bottom of the pool in the shape of a case back, watch case back, and then you have of course a column of 10 meters of water on that coin. So a lot of weight on that coin. And then it's, good question, let's imagine I dive in that pool and I want to move that coin. Is this difficult? I mean, I've never tried that. Is this difficult? I mean, there are 10 meters of water on that coin. Is it then hard to move the coin? Can I pick it up like that? I really don't know this. If you know this, please share it in the comments with us. It would really interest me. And this technology was invented in 1956 by Erwin Piquéré. It was a Swiss company, Erwin Piquéré, and they've invented this method. I think they wanted a strong sign against Rolex, because Rolex was there with the Submariner and with the screw-down crown and a very advanced watch, and they wanted to present something else which great value and engineering in it. And I think this was the main idea behind the compressor and the super compressor. And then I've learned that compressor, super compressor indicate just different sizes. So a compressor is a rather small diver, not for super hard use, and the super compressor, this is the really tough diver. All right, this is the main difference. And recognizing an original compressor watch is very easy, because you can find the helmet of a diver on the case back. Okay, so very easy to see. And this reminds me, by the way, of a very famous diver, and this was Jacques-Yves Cousteau. I think you know the name. But there's a great movie out there, great movie, called L'Odyssée. Oh man, my French. And in English, The Odyssey. I think The Odyssey is the title. And it's a great film about Cousteau and his family and his work and his ship, the Calypso, and diving. Incredible pictures, underwater pictures. And so if you're only slight interest in nature and ocean and diving, and then you should really watch that movie. Big recommendation. Great, great piece. Okay, first question, what's the diver for the beach? A beach beater watch. And in my eyes, it has to be waterproof, replaceable, and affordable, not to say cheap, okay? I think this is very important for a beater watch for the beach, and it has to look good. And in my eyes, this is an incredible good-looking watch. Incredible good looking watch, yeah. Okay, let's go over the basic specifications. 40 millimeters in case diameter, 20 is the lug width. The thickness, to be frank, I haven't measured, but it's a pretty normal, as you can see. Comfortable on the wrist, really comfortable on the wrist. The surfaces are high polished, scratch magnet. The crystal is a plexi, high domed plexi. And this watch retails at, what was it, 450? I think about 450 euros. And let's speak a little bit about the dial, the certain dial design. Goes back to companies like Jaeger-LeCoultre or Blancpain. I think I'm thinking about the 50 Fathoms, for example. Very, very pricey, but fascinating, good looking watches, but not exactly the watch you want to lose in the sand, right? Okay, here you see the two crowns, and this is very classy as well. This pattern here you can find on many vintage inspired dive watches and also on the originals, of course. And on the case back, you see not the helmet, not the famous helmet, which indicates that this is a proper compressor. And you know what? I doubt that this is a compressor. I think they've used the design, but I don't think that there is the technology of a compressor in it, to be frank. Don't think. I don't think that. Don't believe this. And so, yeah, overall, good looking watch. Very affordable. You can pick them up used for, let's say, 200 or what have I paid? I think 220 euros. So roughly $230. And for this little money, I think this is a really, really good looking watch. Let's discuss movement and strap. First, the strap. The strap is a racing strap. Of course, this is a little bit crazy for a diver to be on a racing strap. And this is the original Landeron strap, but okay, it works. But I will replace it. I will replace it for my vacation with something else. Maybe a NATO. Maybe a NATO, I think, or a mesh bracelet. Oh, let me look at this one moment, please. Here we are with mesh bracelets. This could be a good look, a really good look. Yeah. I think this is the way to go. What do you think? Let me know in the comments, please. Really good look. I think I will do this. Mesh bracelet, very cool. I love mesh bracelets. I use them for my Rolex Datejust, and people freak completely out. What are you doing? You cannot match those watches with a mesh, but I wanted to. Okay, the clasp. The clasp is really satisfying, I must say. It's a good working, substantial clasp. Really like it, really like it. I think you can find on Swiss watches, on expensive Swiss watches, you can find a really crappy clasp. As if this thing really is in order. You have this button here, and yeah, works pretty good. So good strap. Really satisfying, but again, I will put it off, and then I will put this maybe on my next chronograph, and the mesh on the diver. Really cool, really cool. And yeah, I will enjoy this watch, I think, for my summer vacation, and well then, yeah, let's see, maybe I sell it on the channel for the 220 I've paid. Don't want to earn money here because the price is so insignificant, so it makes no sense to stretch out every last euro. The movement is a Miyota, and so not a bad movement, but far away from, let's say, Swiss reputation. And somebody, I think somebody has regulated it, or it's pure luck, because it runs plus 2 or 3 seconds. Super precise. Don't know why, to be frank. I don't know if this is normal for this Miyota movement. If anybody knows about the precision of Miyota movements, then please let us know in the comments. Yeah, I think we'll leave it here. That's all I want to say about this good-looking watch. And I think this is the main quality here, is the look. It's not a compressor from the construction side, yes. It's not a famous name on the dial, but overall, it's a really damn good looking watch. Let me put it on the wrist. My wrist is 17 centimeters. I think I can wear it. I can wear it pretty good. Let me use the camera and do this a little differently. Look at this. I think it's a really, really cool piece. What do you think? Let me know in the comments, please. Great watch. Looking forward to wear this on the beach. Okay, and now it's time, I think, to explain how I've handled the situation, the three biggest mistakes with the bodyboard in the ocean. Number one was pulled out by the current on the sea. And the problem there is that you have no longer breaking waves, but you need a breaking wave if you want to go back to the beach. And on the sea, you have a swell without break. And this is very dangerous because the current can then grab you and pull you out of the ocean, far away from the beach, and this is very dangerous. And yeah, but handling this is not so hard. It's hard, but it's not hard to figure out. This is the beach, this is the sea. The current goes, most cases, like this. Makes a curve here. And so this makes no sense to try to swim directly to the beach. You will not manage this against a strong current, even with fins. This is super exhausting. You will not make that. So you swim that way, out of the current, and then back to the next breaking wave, and the next breaking wave will transport you to your family. And yeah, then problem solved, but it's super exhausting. And of course it's scary a little bit, and it's embarrassing because the lifeguards are then on alert, and yeah, it's a little bit embarrassing. The second mistake was knocked out by own board. Oh goodness, and this is so easy to make this error. Sometimes you have waves very close to each other and they are very quick. And then you are with your board, you're facing the first wave, you get over it, and then the second wave comes and you don't see it, and then it smashes your board on your forehead. And maybe, and then actually you can't pass out, but for a few seconds then, okay, we're talking here about 1 or 2 or 3 seconds, and then you are in the treadmill in the tumbler. And I was there then, and I realized there's something missing in my memory. There are some seconds missing, and so very frightened. But you know what? I was a little bit proud of that. I was beaten out by my own board in the middle of the ocean. Wow, this was this stupid manly proudness. I thought, wow, yeah, I've handled that. I mean, I've handled nothing. And I've told this to my girlfriend, and she, yeah, you can imagine what she said to me. Are you out of your mind? Be careful, man. Don't want to see you drowned here. But yeah, I think it was harmless. I think it was harmless. I think it was harmless. And the number three was the big fish. And I was on the surface, I was waiting for the next wave. And then I saw something really dark under me. And I thought, oh shit, what's this? And it moved around. And I've handled nothing. To be frank, I just didn't move anymore. And I thought, go away. And I think very easy explanation. I think it was either a big ball of seagrass, which was in the water, or it was a skate, that big fish with the wings. And they are big, yeah, but they are completely harmless, so no big deal. But to be honest, I think it was seagrass, but it was frightening in this method. And I was very happy when I couldn't see it anymore, and then I went back to the shore and I explained this to my family. And again, are you crazy, man? Are you crazy? Watch out. Yeah, I've done that. I'm not a little bit more cautious. Okay, those were the three mistakes, but relax. It's not so bad to have those situations from time to time. If you are a office guy or a stage jazz musician guy, then sometimes you need the rough nature, right? By the way, I'm thinking about a Q&A video. I'm not sure if you are interested, but I read the same questions in the comments over and over again. And maybe maybe it's a good solution to answer them in a single video. But how to organize this? I think Federico Talks Watches just posts an image on his Instagram site. I have one as well, of course, Caseback Tim. And then you can post your questions under that image, and then I will pick some questions and answer them in a video. Yeah, I think this could work. Or yeah, if you are interested, then please let me know in the comments. Okay, and that's all. Let me thank you very much for your attention, and maybe until next time.